We do welcome you here on this very first Sunday of 2017. Gold Star, you made it to church at 9:30 on January 1st. And we're excited for this new series. But before we get started, we know that New Year's Day is a time when we all take a step back and reflect on our lives. And some of us might have even started to make some resolutions for how things might look in 2017. So why don't we take a quick poll?
Okay, quick show of hands. How many of you have ever made a New Year's resolution? All right, now keep your hands up if that resolution was successful. All right, no. Look around. Look, their hands are still up. These are your coaches.
Take them to the gym.
They're your new workout buddy, yeah. You know, most of us make resolutions, whether at New Year's or simply when we decide that we're ready for a change. When we get motivated and we decide, well, we'll eat less or exercise more, spend more time with friends or family, get our life back together. And we do an okay job at first. We pull it off for a few days. We're really disciplined or motivated by fear or guilt or whatever. But then we gradually start to slide back, right, to our old ways. We give in, we cheat, we take a day off, turns into a week off.
A year
off. Another few years rolls around. And before we know it, our best intentions, they go by the wayside and nothing has changed.
But we want this year to be different for all of us. We want this year to look different for us. Because what would it look like if this could be the year when you had real and meaningful and lasting change in your life? What would it look like if the commitments that you make today and in the next few weeks weren't just fueled by the good intentions or the hope of a blank calendar and a fresh start, but could really change who you are in these next 12 weeks? What if this could finally be the time that you could tackle head on whatever it is that has been holding you back for so long? We believe that this can be that year for you, and that this can be the place to do that. Over these next 12 weeks, we'll be doing that here together as a church, as we start our new sermon series that we're calling 12 Steps. Because resolutions aren't just about hitting the gym a little bit more, while that's great, but it's about taking on the real stuff, that real stuff in our lives that we don't always talk about, but has been holding us back nonetheless. So each week we'll be examining the truth, the hope that the gospel has to offer us, and we'll be looking at the wisdom of the 12 steps and what their community has to teach us as Christians together. So next week, we're going to jump right in next week with step one of the 12-step tradition and partner that with the gospel. But this week, we need to start by backing up and looking at our real lives first.
You know, there's something in your life, I'll bet, that's holding you back. Every single one of us has something that has a hold of us. There's the big ones that we can think of right away, like addiction to drugs or alcohol. Then there's the ones that we don't talk about in polite company, like pornography or gambling. And then there's the other sneaky things that creep their ways into our lives and take the place of where God is supposed to be. An unhealthy focus on image. Behaviors that threaten our family relationships. Overspending to feel secure. Fear. You know, the possibilities are as unique as there are any of us. And they all fall under the big umbrella that we call, in the church, sin. When we try to make ourselves more than we are, or hide and try and be less than we're meant to be as children of God.
You know, we don't know what it is for you, but we're willing to bet that it's slowly taking you apart, keeping you from being the person that God is calling you to be. So, to get ready to do the first step next week, we have to figure out where we're starting from.
And this is where it starts for all of us. That kind of courage, that kind of honesty is where change starts for us. Being honest about what is it right now for you that's holding you back. What is the thing in your life this year that you need to tackle? And that kind of honesty isn't unique to us or to our generation together. And we're going to take a look now at the book of Romans, starting in verse 14. Because Paul, the author of this letter to the Romans, is struggling to be honest in his life. Let's take a look. For we know that the law is spiritual, but I am of the flesh, sold into slavery under sin. All right, so when Paul talks about the law, he's talking about that spiritual code that he tries so hard to follow. And he's saying, you know, in and of itself, that spiritual law is holy and good, and it's a good plan. But he sees in his own life that no matter how hard he tries, as someone who's going to give into temptation, he's going to keep screwing it up. All right, verse 15. I do not understand my own actions, for I do not do what I want, but I do the very thing that I hate. This sentence is the crux of our struggle. I do the things that I hate. I don't even do the things that I want. None of us wake up in the morning and think, you know, today I'm going to do a bad job. Today I'm going to screw something up in my life. We don't start there. But we get to a point where sin lives within us and we're so lost that we don't even know how we got where we are.
So he goes on, verse 16. Now, if I do what I do not want, I agree that the law is good. But in fact, it is no longer I that do it, but sin that dwells within me. For I know that nothing good dwells within me, that is, in my flesh. I can will what is right, but I cannot do it. For I do not do the good I want, but the evil I do not want is what I do. Now, if I do what I do not want, it is no longer I that do it, but sin that dwells within me. So even Paul, the writer of most of the New Testament, he makes resolutions to be better, but he can't do them. He wills what is right, but he can't seem to make it happen. He goes on. 21. So I find it to be a law that when I want to do what is good, evil lies close at hand. For I delight in the law of God in my inmost self, but I see in my members another law at war with the law of my mind, making me captive to the law of sin that dwells in my members. Wretched man that I am, who will rescue me from this body of death? Paul identifies something here that we've all experienced, that inner battle, the conflict between the part of us that wants to get it right, to follow God, to be better, but then there's this other part of us that gets in trouble over and over again, and he feels trapped. Our struggles with the things holding us back are not new. Our struggle is Paul's struggle. Even when we want to do better, we fall short.
So when we left off from Paul, he said, "Who will rescue me from this body of death?" And if that's where our passage ended, we'd be in trouble. But Paul makes one more bold statement at the end of this part of Romans in verse 25. Who will rescue me? Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then with my mind, I am a slave to the law of God, but with my flesh, I am a slave to the law of sin. Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. This last verse reminds us that no matter what happens, no matter what state we're in, we can hold tight to the hope that Christ is with us. We can hold on to the promise that we are never beyond the rescue of Jesus Christ. That there is nothing in our lives that puts us outside of the redemptive work of what God's doing in us. We are a slave to the sin that holds us back, but free by the power of Jesus Christ, our Lord. And that is why this year, why 2017, can be different. Because we have hope not in our ability to get it done, but in the God who we know can get it done in us. We have hope that God isn't done with us yet, that we really can be different this time. And that is the promise of the gospel for us. And these 12 steps give us that systematic way to turn our lives upside down with real relationships and honesty about our lives and the decisions we're making, and to finally get those changes that we're looking for. So what's holding you back in your life? What is that thing that's breaking you all at once? Or one day at a time, you can feel picking you apart. What is that thing for you? And what if you believed, what if you really believed that through hard work and the wisdom of the 12 steps and the transformative power of the gospel, that you could be different?
You know, and there's one more thing. You don't have to do this work alone. In fact, you can't. The church, not just this church, but every church, gets a bad rap that you have to clean yourself up first, that you need to put on your Sunday best and pretend that you have it all together, and then you can come. The sin stays out there, and the righteous people come in here. We all in here know better. We also know that's wrong. Because the church, at its foundation, is a group of people who see the sin in their own lives, who claim with Paul that they are trapped by their behaviors and struggles, and point with hope to the overwhelming grace of God for each of us. That's the foundation for this church. This is a place where you can be honest about your life this year and really start fresh from that honesty. These can be the people that walk with you as you tackle these things that are holding you back. So come back next week as we take the first step together. And if you're ready right now, we have a few opportunities to help get you started.
So each week at 10:30 in the gathering place, which is one of the doors right over here, there'll be a class that Beth is working with here at the church. And this is an opportunity, if you're looking to take these steps deeper in your life, to work those steps in a group and see what that might look like, you can head to the gathering place any week after this service at 10:30. In the chapel, the next door up, there'll be a Stephen minister or a pastor available every week after both services to pray with you. If you've heard something in church and you're thinking, you know, this is me, I'm ready to make a change in my life, whatever that looks like for you, come and let one of us pray for you, because there is nothing more powerful than prayer in your life to help make that new beginning for you. And we'd also encourage you always to find a meeting. If drugs and alcohol are the thing that you're tackling this year, today on Facebook, and then starting next week in the bulletin, we'll have those lists of meetings available to you. And there's one here too, right here at Maitland Prez, that you can start with this week to make a change. So we believe that this year can be different. We believe in the wisdom of the 12 steps and in the transformative power of the gospel for you. This year really can be different. Let's pray. God, we thank you for the courage that you give to each of us if we're willing to reach out and to take it, to be honest about our lives, to take a step back before we can take a step forward and say, God, we can't do this on our own. And there are things in our lives that are keeping us enslaved. Free us, O God, by your work within us, through the partnership of this community, through the wisdom of the 12 steps, knowing that we are never beyond rescue through Jesus Christ our Lord. It is in his powerful and holy name that we pray. Amen.